In this video, we're going to take a look at the tiling optimization workflow provided on the Dynamo blog. This workflow is a multi-objective optimization to reduce material waste and cost within a Revit model. That in mind, let's take a look at the workflow. At this time, we are in Revit 2023 with the Create Study dialog open from Generative Design. In this case, we are going to be able to use this workflow to lay out tiles on a given surface in a Revit model, reducing waste, which means cuts, area wasted, and things like that. Let's go ahead and click on this icon to take a look at the inputs needed for our workflow. All right, so with any generative design graph, we have the title, the description, the author, and the learn more URL. This links to the blog post, which is also linked in the description box below. In addition to the blog posts, all these sample files are provided, and those are in the link as well. I encourage you to download them to be able to follow along with this workflow. For our first input, we require a base face to lay out the tiling on. In this case, in our model, we do have a floor that we can use for this. Additional inputs include the tile width and tile length. In this case, for this example, I know that I want to lay out a 2x4 ceiling grid, so I'm going to constrain those to 2 and 4. You can absolutely check these and let those be variable though to figure out which tile fits best on your surface given a range of values. That's really nice when you have products to select from and you want to see which ones will fit the best. So that is an option available to you with this workflow. Our next inputs are the width offset, length offset, and rotation. These parameters allow the workflow to perform the optimization required to calculate the waste and the optimal placement of these tiles. In this case, width offset goes from 0 to 1. That is a parameter along the U value of the surface. The length offset is a value from 0 to 1 as well, and that goes for the V value of the surface. Rotation, it allows us to rotate the tiles to be able to figure out the ideal placement of these tiles. This is another parameter that you can absolutely uncheck and lock as a constraint if you know which orientation you want your tiles to be in. I'll leave it checked for now. Our final inputs are the sloped glazing type we're going to use and a ceiling or floor level. These inputs are important because with generative design, we are creating all this geometry in the viewport, which is really nice, but it is always much nicer to be able to actually create Revit elements. That's where one of the biggest strengths of generative design is. In this case, in the sample file, we include a sloped glazing element that has a ceiling tile built in. It also has the T-grid built into it as well. So if we go ahead and draw a quick roof just to preview this, we will see that if I were to go through and start laying out grids, I could lay these out how they make sense. So 4-foot tiles, perhaps, by 2-foot. We will start to see that we have a ceiling tile and we have a T-grid automatically built in as well. This is really useful because we can use these tiles downstream in other software like Navisworks to preview the grids for coordination issues. So it's really nice to be able to model these elements very quickly in this way. I'm going to delete that roof for now because we don't need it. And we'll go ahead and take a look at our goals. For this workflow, our goals are to maximize the amount of full tiles and minimize the partial tiles. For this to be multi-objective optimization, we are also minimizing the partial tile area and the discarded area. These values are available in the workflow as outputs, so you could start to use that to be able to figure out where to reuse this material down the line. That's a really nice example of a potential next step for this workflow, so I encourage you to check it out. Part of the goal with these videos and these blog posts is to give you Dynamo graphs to dissect and learn from. They're not meant as an end-all, they're meant as something to guide you in the direction of what is possible with generative design. In this case, we don't have any constraints for this workflow. You can explore those as well. And for generation settings, we have the population set at 20, the generation set at 10, and the seed set at 1. We'll leave those as default right now. In the description below, we'll link to some documentation on these inputs. But with that in mind, let's go ahead and click on Generate. By default, Generative Design will run a few instances of Dynamo behind the scenes. So it is currently running through all these runs, changing the variables, and it's going to provide us some results shortly. Let's go ahead and let this run, and we'll take a look at those results here in a moment. Another great feature of generative design is the ability to preview the results as it's running. So as you can see, we're seeing it start to actively solve for what works best for all of our goals. Awesome. With that complete, we can see that we have a few results to choose from at this point. Let's go ahead and make this full screen to be able to review these results. So in this case, you can click on each one of these thumbnails and navigate and kind of look at the result to see what you think of it. In this case, all these look pretty similar, and that's partially because I have a known tile width. So in this case, I could see all these partials at the bottom. If I click on this one, we'll see that those are way skinnier, so we're cutting a smaller tile in that case. So using my own assumptions, I can think, oh, it'll probably be easier to manufacture this one or something like that. With this in mind, we are using a 2x4 tile, so it is a known tile width. So you are also able to constrain the rotation if you know that you want the tiles to go the other way, for instance. So that is another option available to you. In this case, I want to go ahead and filter down these results a bit more. So I do know that I want to reduce the discarded area as much as I can. So we can go ahead and click on the line chart below, filter these out, and we'll see that we have 5 results that work better than some of the others. In this case, we're minimizing the discarded area, the partial tile area, and the partial tile count. In addition, we can see that our full tiles are going to be slightly higher on one of these runs. So if we click through, we actually start to highlight those run results for ourselves as well, which is really nice. In this case, this one looks pretty good to me. So what we'll go ahead and do is we'll tile this down and we'll go ahead and create some real Revit elements. In this case, in generative design, it is really nice to have access to all of the geometry preview and the viewport, but it's always nice to be able to pack this data into something in Revit that is a real Revit element. In this case, if we click on Create Revit Elements, this will currently create that roof element for us. And with that complete, we can see that this representation in Revit matches that representation in generative design. We can see all of our full tiles and all of our partial tiles. What's really great about this is we can now quantify all of these elements within this sloped glazing. So if we were to select all the panels on this host, we can see that we have a total of 627 panels. You can schedule these and you can start to figure out all of the data associated with these panels. They also look really great in rendering, and you can view these in software like Navisworks once again. As a last step, let's go ahead and take a quick look at the Dynamo graph right in Dynamo. In order to do this, I'm going to go ahead and close the Explore Outcomes dialog, click on Create Study once again, and a really quick tip for being able to edit these workflows in Dynamo is to just click on this little pencil icon to edit it in Dynamo. We're going to close the Create Study dialog, and we'll take a look at the graph. So the graph is fully annotated with notes, so keep that in mind as you dissect this workflow. Generally speaking, we have our inputs at the beginning that we already covered. We have remember nodes to cache the surface that we need to use. And we have some geometry nodes here in the center to be able to calculate the tiling. Once again, all of these groups are annotated to explain the logic involved in creating this workflow. This portion up at the top right creates the Revit elements. So in this section, we're actually creating the roof element, adding the grids, rotating the grids, and being able to use that roof. For the Dynamo preview, that's going to be down in this bottom right section of the graph as well. So it provides all of the outputs for us and all of the geometry preview in generative design. With that in mind, I encourage you to take this sample graph. It's bundled in the description box below with all the packages involved to make this happen. Break it apart, add some of your own nodes to it, and you can start to solve for some of these tiling workflows that are really nice to use. So multi-objective optimization is a workflow that's really useful because we're able to generate many results to choose from. A lot of times when we're building generative design workflows, we use a single objective optimization and we get one result. It is more satisfying when you can start to optimize for several goals and pick and choose which is most important to you. So in this case, I picked the goal that resulted in the most tiles that are whole. In addition, this looks pretty centered on the space, which is really nice. So that is another option available to us to be able to visually inspect these things to create elements. There you have it. Be sure to check out the workflow below. Let us know if you have any comments, and thanks for checking out this tutorial.